This is History in the Haversack, coming to you from the halls of the New England Civil War Museum, where we connect the people of today with the memories and the humanity of the people of the American Civil War. I'm Matt Valier, Program Director.
And I'm Cara Kaminsky, Collections Director.
And I'm Dan Hayden, Curator and Exhibit Designer.
And today we're joined by a couple good friends of mine. They are from Victorian Photo Studio in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. We have Brandon and owner of the company, Dave. So guys, introduce yourselves.
All right, hey, how are you guys? My name is Dave. I'm the owner of Victorian Photography Studio in Gettysburg, located right on Steinway Avenue, right across from the Dobbin House. We offer a 19th century photography studio experience for all of our clients. You can come in and get tintypes and ambrotypes and even digital photographs if you want, using our period correct photography parlor and all of our authentic dresses and wardrobe and uniforms and props.
Hey, everybody. So my name is Brandon Benner. I've been one of the photographers at Victorian Photography Studio for almost 2.5 years now. So right around the beginning of 2021, my buddy Dave, who we've just been history nerd friends for years and years, he brought me in and taught me everything I know about the process, and I've just been loving it ever since. I kind of came into wet plate, I think, a similar way that Dave did. We just kind of learned everything from the ground up. Dave literally taught me the basics on the first day, and I've just been kind of running with it since then. So I'm seeing it from the point of view of an apprentice, and it's just such a fun process, not just the photography, but working there. I love getting to walk people through this historic process and teach them the material culture and just the culture of the time period surrounding this process. Really makes it a very special place to work.
We are all
Great.
very jealous of every time Matt comes back from Gettysburg with a new image of him looking exactly like he had just walked right out of the 1860s.
The nice part about that is you don't even have to come all the way to Gettysburg. Since I have both Brandon and our studio manager, Kim Corradetti, running the Gettysburg location, that's allowed me to travel. And so I actually just got back from Connecticut last week. I was at Marquis Jewelry Academy in Stonington. So I get on the road a lot. It allows me to kind of go where the demand is. And so I get all over New England, the Northeast, some of the Mid-Atlantic region and the upper South, and then all the way out to the Northern Midwest. So kind of all over the place. And in December, we're going to be doing a very small little European tour in Switzerland, Germany, England, and Ireland. So we're kind of taking our show on the road.
Wow, that's a small trip.
Yeah.
Right. Tell us a little bit about how you came into wet plate photography and how you came across Victorian Photo Studio.
I had absolutely no photo background whatsoever. I didn't take any in high school. I've never taken a workshop. I've never had a class. I kind of stumbled into it when we lived in Gettysburg. I had been a reenactor since the early 90s, mid-90s, I guess, and lived in Rock Island, Illinois for a class field trip. And I want to say first grade, so like 1991, we went to the Rock Island Arsenal, and there was a Confederate cemetery there as part of the museum that's on the island. And so I got really, really interested in the Civil War and just really had to know more about it. And then as a reenactor, ended up having my wet plate taken a handful of times by artists like Rob Gibson and Todd Harrington and Wendell Decker and those guys, a bunch of the guys who kind of refounded it again in the 90s. And so I was always interested in it. I had an idea of how it all worked, but I just never actually done it or even really had the interest in doing it myself. But when we lived in Gettysburg, an artist friend of mine named Chantel from Switzerland, she came to the park to be the artist in residence and asked if we could go get a tintype done. And so I took them to the studio, and the former owners, who I'd known for a while, were looking to retire soon and casually mentioned that they were looking for somebody to take it over. And Chantel was like, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, you should do that. And so yeah, I with no background whatsoever and just an idea that I could probably pull it off, I bought the studio and started learning from there.
Wow, that's really awesome. I will say, I've always enjoyed my experience going into Victorian Photo Studio, whether it's in the studio in Gettysburg or did I really say Gettysburg? Gettysburg or on the road. So if you are in Gettysburg, make sure you stop by.
We
I
also have a
think I've
location in Gettysburg, but it's hard to find.
Isn't that in Sweden, right? Gettysburg.
Yes, Gettysburg.
we kind of want to know a little bit about kind of the origins of wet plate photography and then how that leads up to the Civil War. Between you both, Dave and Brandon, if you could kind of give us a little bit of background history there.
So photography kind of starts around the early 1830s in France. There's a gentleman whose name I can't remember because he died and didn't get to put his name on anything. So I don't remember what he was called, but his student is fairly famous, and his student, his name is Louis Daguerre. So Louis Daguerre picks up around 1833 what his teacher had been working on, which was photography, capturing light on silver and turning it into a, you know, a reproducible image. And so for the next several years, he's really working on fine-tuning this process and making it functional and reproducible and, you know, consistent. And so by like 1838, 1839, he's ready to debut it at the World's Fair in Paris. And so he debuts the daguerreotype, which is a very, very sharp, very fine, very meticulous form of photography. In fact, it's still, you know, even though it was the first recognized form of photography, it's still the sharpest, strongest, most focused type of photography we have, because it's literally shot on the atomic level. It's changing the molecular structure of atoms to recreate this photography, which means you can zoom in to an infinite enough level and still not have it break down. I try and explain that to people in like digital camera terms. Like, let's say you have a 1,000,000 megapixel camera, which is pretty wild. Like, 1,000,000 megapixels is a lot. At some point, when you zoom it all the way in, it's still just a collection of squares. It's just a collection of little right angles. And so you're going to eventually pixel out. Daguerreotypes don't do that. If you get a chance to go on like the Library of Congress website, they've done like incredibly high, like 120,000 DPI scans of old photos, and you can zoom in just infinitely and see such great detail. The problem with the daguerreotype is it's dangerous and it's impractical to do, and it's hard to do on the road, like outside of a studio setting. In the late 1840s or early 1850s, there's two gentlemen, Frederick Scott Archer and Henry Fox Talbot, who are trying to figure out a new way to do quicker, easier photography. And so they both come up almost simultaneously with wet plate collodion, which is using like a halide suspension to coat liquid silver on a glass or tin plate. And that's what you're going to use to kind of collect this light. Whereas the daguerreotype was a silver plate that was silver electroplated onto a copper plate and then buffed to a mirrored finish. And then it was sensitized with boiled iodine. And then you would develop it with boiling mercury and misting mercury vapors onto the plate, which creates a really nice image, but it's really, really difficult to judge when your development's finished. You don't get to see light developing. So you had to be pretty well mastered at your craft to understand how to even shoot a good daguerreotype. And the other very unique thing about daguerreotype is that it's technically a negative, but that negative mirrors itself off that glass plate. And so it's also a positive at the same time. So it's really cool when you're holding a daguerreotype in your hand, you can turn it certain ways, almost like a hologram, and it will be both a negative and a positive. It gives it a very eerie 3D feel. It's not something you see anywhere else in any other type of photography. So when wet plate collodion came around, it's faster, it's quicker, it's easier. Everybody can do it. It does not quite have that same fineness that a daguerreotype has. And so there's a little bit of pushback, but that quickly goes away. I liken it to digital cameras coming out in like the early 90s. Film purists were like, look at this trash. It's 1.2 megapixel camera. Like, these things are garbage. They're not true art. You know, they're disposable for the masses. You know, true artists use film. So back then it was true artists do daguerreotypes. But we would even now consider wet plate collodion a very fine process compared to a lot of like film from the 70s, 80s, 90s, early digital, stuff like that. It's still a really, really fine and sharp and unique style. But in the early 1850s, they were comparing it against daguerreotype, and it just didn't quite hold up. Now, it really took off in the United States, and there were a whole lot of practitioners, both amateur and professional. And so that made it the perfect catalyst to be used for photojournalism, which came about in the 1860s when the Civil War started.
Like Dave was saying, you know, when wet plate collodion comes along, it becomes just this process that's so much more democratized than the daguerreotype. So more people can access it, not just photographers, because it's an easier process to work with, but just customers as well. By 1861, when the Civil War starts, it is not uncommon at all for an average American to, you know, possibly have a picture taken of themselves. It's fairly affordable. It's easy enough where a lot of American families can just go down to their local town square on a Sunday afternoon and sit for a portrait. You know, we kind of have this notion from like old timey times that, oh, you only got it once done like once in your life. Like, it was still fairly affordable. You could do this often enough. Even before the war begins, we're seeing this cultural revolution that this technology brings. Something I love to tell people about, you know, just how revolutionary this technology was, is picture, you know, somebody who's a 19-year-old kid at the beginning of the Civil War. He probably did not know what his great-grandfather looked like because he probably died long before he himself was born. Most people can't afford to get like an oil painting done of their family member or something like that. So unless you've got a very talented artist in the family, you don't really have a good depiction of what maybe a distant family member looked like. You just have to go off of oral descriptions. With technology now, you can preserve an image for posterity for the foreseeable future. Of course, we still have these images bouncing around today. So that's an immediate impact that it has on American culture. And it just explodes with the coming of the U.S. Civil War. And, you know, we all know what these pictures look like. We can imagine just the hundreds of thousands of young men who are going off to war in 1861. And they go and get their picture taken before they leave because they want to record this moment, not just in their lives, but in history, and just keep it preserved. So we've got all these incredible images that are still bouncing around in antique shops, garage sales. You know, they're traded back and forth amongst collectors because there's just so many of them because it was such an accessible technology. Now, as Dave alluded earlier, it can be taken on the road too. And that's where photojournalism comes in. We see pioneers of photojournalism start taking root almost immediately as the war begins. So we see guys like Alexander Gardner, Timothy O'Sullivan, who are following the armies on campaign. Sometimes, you know, their images are a little more mundane. Various photographers may go and visit certain regiments in the field and take pictures of whole companies just out on dress parade. So you can see what an army camp looks like. That's something that people on the home front can see for the first time without going to Virginia or Tennessee or something like that themselves. But it gets all the more real later on, especially with the Battle of Antietam on September 17, 1862. Once the armies leave the area of Sharpsburg, Maryland, photographers start showing up. And this is one of the first occasions where we have these mass-produced and mass-disseminated images of the aftermath of battle. These are horrific images of men literally torn apart, lying dead in heaps on the battlefield, horses lying dead, just the wreckage of battle. And this is brought home into people's living rooms. Matthew Brady, one of the leading photographers of his time, has a gallery in New York City in which he displays a lot of these photographs, and people can just walk into the gallery and witness the reality of warfare. And that, I think, really shifts Americans' conception of war. It made it all the more real and made them understand this will not be a quick, easy, or glorious conflict. And I think it changed Americans' taste for war, not just for the rest of that conflict, but forever, I think. And that's a legacy that is carried on to this very day. We think about that when we look at images from modern war zones, from the Iraq War, the war in Afghanistan. Those are direct descendants of those first photographers of the battlefields at Antietam.
One thing that I kind of tell people giving tours at the museum in the combat experience part of the tour, that we have, there are some photos that you were just speaking about, Brandon. One thing I kind of equate it to is what was going on during the Vietnam War. I mean, you had war correspondents in the middle of firefights, and people were seeing that on television, and that created a certain kind of atmosphere in the American public. Sure, you know, these photographers during the Civil War weren't setting up a camera right in the middle of Pickett's Charge or the cornfield at Antietam. You know, I feel like that's kind of almost a similar aspect.
Definitely. Yeah, it brings the unedited look of war in front of the American people. Just like a momentary sidebar, Just last week I listened to a podcast called it's called Do We Get to Win This Time, and it's a look at the Vietnam conflict portrayed through American cinema. And one of the like big things that they pointed out was Americans interacted a little differently with Vietnam movies because they tended to be more gritty. When they look at World War II movies, they're mostly coming out after the fact as kind of a part of a propaganda machine. But people don't really have the same appetite for Vietnam movies because they are seeing the real war on their television sets in their living room every night. And it changes their perception of the conflict very quickly. And I think it's the exact same thing that happens for Americans of the 1860s vis-a-vis Americans of the 1960s. Americans on the home front in 1863, they don't have to just look at a Currier and Ives print or some fanciful woodcut where every single guy is in perfect parade formation, marching gallantly across a field. No, I mean, they're seeing what it actually looks like on a battlefield without having to actually go there themselves.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point there, in that this was the first example of where it became so realistic for people rather than the romantic view of war. And then we charged down the slope towards the enemy and we captured the day. And, you know, yes, there were men lost, but they died gloriously on the field of battle. Well, gloriously is rather graphic in reality. And so out of that curiosity, this is my understanding, and I'm hoping you could correct me or expand on this. The Crimean War was actually the first war which was actually photographed in some manner. Do you think that, first of all, A, is that correct? And then B, is did Americans see that? Did they have some sort of prime for this? Or would that have been entirely within the British population?
So it's a kind of yes and no. Yes, it was the very first photographed war, but it wasn't photographed the way the American Civil War was. It was mostly still kind of like romanticized, posed photos of British soldiers, you know, in their full dress uniforms. It's highly curated by the British government as far as what gets seen. And there really aren't any depictions of casualties or aftermath. There's, from what I've seen, there's one or two photos of like cannonballs strewn all over the road, but like, that's about it as far as like the grittiness of the Crimean War. It's on daguerreotype, so it's not an easy method to be shooting on anyway. But like nobody was going down to the field after the Light Brigade charged and taking a photo of that aftermath. It was a lot of guys in kilts and feather bonnets and, you know, officers in their camps and a lot of kind of just, well, we're the might of the British Army and this is how we look on, you know, on campaign. It was a lot of parade ground type stuff that was still in the vein of those woodcuts, like the Mexican War, you know, the Currier and Ives type stuff too.
It's still a curated presentation yeah, of so. What the war
there's would a, have been. What's the other lithograph guys? I can see him because every Confederate's wearing exactly like perfect parade ground stuff. Kurtz and Allison. Yeah, that's it. Yeah. Just like never once in the entirety of the war did anybody look like that, you know? I mean, these guys, they all have matching facial hair in most of the pictures too, you know. It's incredibly romanticized. Doesn't look anything like what actually happened. And the Crimean War daguerreotypes can kind of be lumped into the same thing. Like, it's a lot of camp poses, and it's a lot of guys who've been told to dress up. You're not seeing the stragglers dying of thirst on the road. You know, like, it's just, that's not what they were taking pictures of. They weren't doing that. They were still showing the might and greatness of the British Army. And the American Civil War kind of flips that all on its head because it's like, here's what's going on, like whether you like it or not. There was plenty of debate, too, about whether they should even be allowed to show that.
Oh, and that was my next question. What I was going to ask you is, after Brady had first like shown the public these very shocking things, was there a response of, this is not that anybody would want to see it, but this is something that is inappropriate for us to see? Was there a component of that from the public?
And that came both from the government and from just the general public. Everybody kind of wants to see the car crash unless you know the people in it, and that was kind of where things were going with this. And it's still that way. You go on Reddit right now and you can find subgenres where they're practically live streaming the Ukrainian war right now because there's so many drones. I mean, you can just tap into the Ukrainian live streams and watch trenches getting stormed, watch getting people getting blown in half in real time. Is that an ethics violation? You know, you could certainly debate it. Is there an appetite for it? Apparently so. that's kind of always been the problem in reporting on wars is like, should people see it and do they want to? And where do we find that balance?
I think what we see there, we see some parallels between how photography was used in the Civil War era, how film was used in the Vietnam era, and now how drone footage is used in the eras of modern war in Eastern Europe. You know, initially they're used for art, entertainment. Then things shift, they begin to be used for documentation of the hard realities of our world. And that's going to create friction and maybe some discomfort in society.
One thing I wanted to ask, because I know when you look at photos of, per se, like the Battle of Gettysburg, and this is a very common image that we've seen if you ever looked up like Gettysburg battlefield, is the unfortunate passed on soul at the sharpshooter's nest there in Devil's Den there. You know, everybody's seen that, but it was proved that that was a staged photo, that they had used a dead soldier to shoot that. One thing that always passes through my mind is like, why would they pose a dead soldier instead of just shooting where he already was?
Well, they did shoot him where he already was and then moved him like three more times and took more pictures.
Oh, geez.
So you can find what we assume is his original resting place right down near the creek. And then they pull him up to kind of where the Alfred Woad Rock is. And then they haul him up the hill to the quote unquote sharpshooter's nest, which looks pretty built by the photographers as well, too. So kind of feel like that wasn't there during the fighting. And so they just kind of thought, hey, this looks pretty good. We could definitely sell more prints of this than we would of just some rando laying down by the creek.
I heard recently that guy may not have even really been killed in the fighting on July 2nd, like the narrative often is. I heard it's possible he may have actually been killed on July 3rd in the engagements around the South Cavalry Field, like Farnsworth's Cavalry Brigade coming in and hitting the Texas Brigade. So it's just such a weird little odyssey that poor kid took.
I think it's important to note, too, that the Victorians, and we'll get into this more in our next episode, but the Victorians were much more comfortable with death. They processed all of the bodies in the home. You didn't have funeral parlors in the way that we have them today. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I've heard that they actually took a lot of post-mortem photos. You know, you'd have a kid that passed on a little too early. You didn't get a picture of them yet. Well, just prop them up with the rest of the family and take a picture, because at least you'll have that.
So half of that's correct. This is where I get into a million internet arguments. Postmortem photography is very popular in the Victorian era. And by Victorian era, I mean basically the short period of time from the 1860s to maybe the 1880s. By 1890s, turn of the century, it's really not nearly as popular as it had been. And also, it's not as staged as you would assume from so many internet sites. Postmortems kind of have a look to them, and they're almost always going to be the corpse being laid down somewhere, the propped body, the stand behind the neck, they painted the rosy cheeks to make them look lifelike. None of that's real. We use posing stands every day in the studio, and they can't hold anything up. I know none of you have probably tried to pose a dead body before, but it's not really easy to do. They're either a really heavy lifeless sack or already turned rigid. So getting anything to cooperate that way, even modern morticians, I'm sure you've probably seen like crazy BuzzFeed articles of like, oh, this guy had his funeral propped up on his motorcycle, and they don't look anywhere near lifelike, even though they've tried their best. So the myth of the lifelike postmortem is really just a great way for unscrupulous eBay sellers to get a lot more money for their random photos. There's so many factors that people like to point out, like, oh, this, look how white their eyes are. They must be dead. In the collodion color scale, the color blue turns white most of the time. So they probably just have glassy blue eyes, or they talk about like, oh, their hands looking dark or skin looking a different color. That could also be skin just being flushed. When your skin turns red or any red colors in collodion, it turns dark. So when I take photos of people in modern times who have rosacea or freckles or a sunburn, or they're just sweating too much, like their skin will come out a lot more bronzy or dark, or even if the light isn't right, like their hands will come out kind of black. They're all very much alive because they paid me when they're done, but they're not dead, even though they can sort of look like that sometimes. As much as postmortems were very popular, the way in which they were done was not so much what our popular media likes to explain it as.
So pretty much they're going to look dead when you look at the picture.
If they look alive, they're alive. If they look dead, they're probably pretty close to dead.
Okay.
Although I've taken some photos of some people who look pretty dead and they are not. So,
Cara, to return to your point, though, you're absolutely right. You know, people of the Victorian era were much more comfortable with death than we are today. And that is shown in the postmortem photos that do exist. So like Dave said, just keep an eye out for the ones that aren't real, though. That said, just anytime I think about postmortem photography, there's one particular picture that I always think of, and it bounces around on the internet every now and then. This one is a verified Civil War postmortem photograph, and I think it's one of the most heartrending photographs I've seen from this conflict. It was an Ohio cavalryman from a little tiny town in Northeast Ohio. He had been a prisoner of war until like right at the end of the war, managed to get exchanged, came home, and then died of disease within about a week of being home. And he's dressed in his uniform. He is one of the only known photographs of a Civil War soldier post-mortem in uniform. They like hand-colored the yellow trim on his cavalry jacket. And there's a set of two photographs, one of him laying there posed with his mother and the other with his father. And they both just have this exhausted look on their face, just destroyed. So when I think of post-mortem photography, you know, we get the charlatans out there on eBay who are just looking to make a quick buck, but that's the reality of it. These were people making one last memory with someone that they didn't get to spend enough time with. That's not a pleasant picture, but if you ever see it, I encourage you to spend some time with it if you do find it somewhere.
And you're also exactly right about, you know, the people back then being more comfortable with death being around them and having their family members die at home. And with the type of photography that we do, we end up in the paranormal community a lot. And so, you know, we're checking out if somebody died in this home. I'm like, yeah, if it was built before 1970, guaranteed people died in that home. It's not something out of the ordinary. Like up until, you know, the 1980s, 1990s, dying in a hospital, dying in hospice was not common. Most people just died at home. Almost all of my great grandparents and grandparents have died at home. And that's just kind of the reality of it. But, you know, we wouldn't think of that now. If whatever's happening to you, you're taken to a hospital and that's where you expire. But back then, and back then means like within the last 30 years, yeah, death at home was just kind of a thing. And it's not overly spectacular to have a home that somebody died in.
So Dave, you mentioned something interesting there before about the way that colors show up on these here. Are you, when you look at a photograph taken around that time with your experience, is there a consistent, easy way to tell what that original color would have been?
Unfortunately, no. And that's what leads to a lot of squabbles in like the historical costuming community or the reproduction community. I recently had to settle, well, I guess not recently, about 5 years ago, kind of settle an argument between some people in the Clara Barton Society who wanted to reproduce one of her dresses. And there's a couple of people who are arguing that it was a dark red and some arguing it was a dark green. And I looked at the picture and I said, I'm pretty sure it's like turquoise. No, it can't be turquoise. There's no way. I was like, I have a dress and it photographs the exact same way. So tell you what, you guys send me a bunch of color swatches. I'll shoot a tintype of them. Then you can kind of decide which one it was. So I put them all on there and I numbered them. I didn't tell them which ones were which. And I took a swatch of turquoise fabric that I had as well too and put it up there. And they all agreed that number three was definitely it. And that was the one that I put up and not any of the ones that they sent me. And I said, yeah, there's certain ways that colors react and that the type of material reacts to. So to kind of give a long story short on it, the cameras that they used in the 1860s were run off of chemicals. And those chemicals, which we're just going to refer to as collodion, worked off a unique color scale. That color scale only worked off of ultraviolet light. So anything that is in the, let's say, 400 to 450 nanometer range, which is kind of where like the purplish, bluish ultraviolet light resides, that's going to develop really, really quickly. So your light purples, your light blues, even like maybe your kind of royal blues, are going to come out significantly lighter than you would expect them to. Now, conversely, on the extreme other side, in the 700, 750, 800 nanometer range, you have red and yellow. This is why we can use a red light in the dark room, because it's practically zero light. as far as the collodion scale is concerned. So you look at a lot of these photos of wildly bright Zouave uniforms, and they come out very, very drab because those bright red pants are coming out really dark. As I was saying before, if you've got rosacea, if you have flushed skin, red turns dark. Look at photos of Plains Native Americans, and they look incredibly dark. That red pigment in their skin. Early photos of Asian Americans who have just come over and working on the railroads and working outside, and they've got that really dark complexion. There's the yellow tones in their skin, the red tones in their skin, all of that's coming out and pulling naturally dark in the wet plate collodion scale. And so you find that also just looking at random Civil War uniforms. There's a lot of early Confederate images where it looks like the trim and the chevrons on their uniforms are black, especially like Mississippi and Louisiana troops. And so for the longest time in the Civil War community, reenactors would be recreating the uniforms and putting black trim on, even though the regulations that we find on paper say that infantry were wearing red. So, well, here's all these pictures and they're wearing black. Red turns black in the collodion color scale. So looking at that with our modern eyes, we're not quite getting the right picture. And so a lot of people will also get the wrong, I don't know what the word is, the wrong inkling that most Victorian clothing was fairly drab because we're only seeing it in grayscale, not realizing that you could have a bright red jacket and it would come out very dark, or you could have bright yellow or even some oranges that come out really, really, really drab. And also your bright blues. There's a lot of dresses that I've taken photos of that are white with like periwinkle or powder blue stripes or pattern, and they come out all one color because that periwinkle and blue develops so quickly, it comes out on the same scale as all the white.
So if I took a photograph of myself in my uniform and I did the let's turn it black and white filter on there, it's going to look mm-hmm. different than if I had you photograph it using the wet plate technology.
Absolutely. And there was even this is right around 2020. There was one of those apps that like colorized old photos. And so people were throwing them up there all the time. Like, oh, this is what it would have looked like in color. It really just kind of blue toned a lot of things. So what was kind of cool was I would have digital photos of some of my clients, as well as the wet plate. And then we would also put the wet plate into that app and see how close it came to real life. Because we had the real life photo, we had the tintype, and then we had what the app thought real life would look like. Sometimes it was kind of close. A lot of times it was way off. It went for green a lot. Like it went for blues and greens all the time. But, you know, I have a lot of clients who come in with some pretty gaudy dresses and they just come out somewhat flat sometimes as a tintype. And so it was interesting to see what the AI thought it could do. And it just didn't quite understand all the little intricacies of wet plate. And I've been doing it long enough, I can get a pretty good idea of how something is. I'm also colorblind in real life. So watching things translate in collodion actually helps me decipher between things. Like if I can't tell if it's brown or red and I shoot it in a wet plate and it comes out about the regular tone that it should be, then it's definitely brown because red would go a lot darker. If I can't tell if it's purple or blue, if it goes, you know, like significantly lighter, it's probably blue. And if it stays kind of where it's at in like a gray scale, it's probably purple. So it helps me out because I don't know the difference of the real colors most of the time. So it kind of puts me in a collodion scale as well.
That actually answers a question of I've always had about a photograph that it's of my wife's great, great, great grandfather who mm-hmm. transferred into the Veterans Reserve Corps. And of course, I knew he was federal. So when it photographs light, I know he wasn't Confederate. He was not wearing a gray jacket. But what I've never quite understood is that all the trim, all the dark blue trim that's on there, it must have been a lighter shade of indigo because it just washes out and it doesn't look like the modern day in-person jacket examples of what the VRC was wearing at the time. So that they all look washed out and light. I know it was probably a lighter shade of indigo.
It's another interesting thing that we see at the studio too, between the different levels of authenticity in reproduction clothing and how the camera can weed that out. If you put two frock coats next to each other, one of them just kind of a very basic Sutler Rose frock coat made of modern RIT dye, and then one made of true indigo dye. The indigo colors are so lush and so rich, and the RIT dye either turns like the dark blue will turn really, really black, and the light blue will turn really, really white. And then you get on the more authentic ones, you get those really good mid-tones of like nice, rich gray colors. It's interesting to see them side by side because our eyes don't see too much of a difference. But the camera's like, well, this one's really good and this one's really not.
One thing that I was always curious about, and it seems to be a fairly popular practice, especially during the Civil War, was the production of CDVs. What is a CDV and how did they go about producing those?
So CDV stands for I don't speak a whole lot of French, but I'll do the very best I can here. It stands for carte de visite, like visiting card, basically is what it means. What you would get these things for is you would have a negative taken of yourself on glass, for instance, through the wet plate process. And then you would have that image replicated en masse on little pieces of paper. And those were your CDVs, your visiting cards. What you would do with those is you basically use them like trading cards of yourself. You would hand them out to family, friends. You'd get a bunch from all your family and friends, and everybody would just kind of keep them together in a little album. Now, where the word album comes from relates to how we make CDVs. Originally, photographers in the Victorian era were making these from the negatives by soaking paper in a solution of albumin, which is egg white. So they would literally have chicken coops in the backyards of their studios so they could have enough eggs to supply this process. But they would mix this albumin with some other chemicals, put the paper behind the glass negative and leave it out in the sun, and they would create this impression on this albumin impregnated paper. That would be one of the processes to create your CDV. But that's how the word album comes along. You would get these albumin prints, slip them into a book of your CDVs, and boom, you got an album.
Photographers were finding out they can make a whole lot more money by selling copies than they could of just taking photo after photo after photo. And so glass plate photography really, really catches on around this time, especially using what's called a gem camera, which is a camera that has anywhere from 4 to 8 lenses. And so it takes 4 to 8 identical photos of the subject and through a partitioned camera shoots all of those onto a large piece of glass. And then you're going to place that glass negative over the albumin paper. And then boom, out of nowhere, you've got 8 prints. Reproducing images before that was pretty much impossible other than taking a picture of a picture. And, you know, we all know that that loses quality as it goes. So this was a fast way, you know, if you get a high-end client like Abraham Lincoln rolling in there and you want to capitalize on that, you shoot one big gem plate of him and then you just make more and more and more and more and more and sell them. And that's how you get all these CDVs of generals all over the place. Because now that you have that glass negative too, you essentially have the copyrights and you can sell that negative to other people and they can make copies. And that's how Brady ended up getting his name on so many images, because photographic copyright laws really didn't exist yet. And so any plate that he bought from another photographer would become a quote unquote Brady image, whether he shot it or not. So there's a lot of photos attributed to him that he had nothing to do with other than making money off of.
When it comes to New England and photography during the Civil War, are there any names or studios that kind of come to mind?
I can't think of anything off the top of my head. I mean, I can think of some famous like New England photos. There's Joseph Pierce from 14th Connecticut, 12th Connecticut, who for the longest time was widely considered to be the only Chinese American soldier to fight in the American Civil War. However, a friend of mine, Annalise Mack, I think is her last name, at Genesee Country Village, she's done an exhaustive report on Asian Americans who fought in the American Civil War. I think she's up to 60 or 70 identified Asian American soldiers now. Pierce may be the only one that I think there's an image of, but her study is awesome. I don't know if she's published it or what yet, but she is the Young Sophisticate, and so is spelled S-E-W on Instagram. If you get a chance to link her up after this, really interesting work that she's been doing on the role of Asian and Pacific Islanders in the American Civil War and in the Victorian era in general.
That's really cool. I know in our interpretation, as you go through the museum, on one of the posters we have in the kind of enlistment area, we do have a small reproduction of that photo of Joseph Pierce. So that's a really cool one. People usually ask about it when we're giving a guided tour. You know, we kind of highlight on the fact that some units were put together because of an ethnic identity. So he's got a very interesting story that I definitely don't know about. I'm sure maybe Dan, who's more familiar with the 14th than I am, would be able to talk a little bit about him.
Well, he's actually, and this is actually, we got the right people on the call, because the photograph of him that you're referencing, so he's sitting there in a frock coat, he's wearing his corporal stripes, and he's got his arm jauntily on a table there. And the colors of his clothes are all very different, right? So he's wearing a frock coat, which is probably the dark blue, right? And you have trousers, which appear even darker than that. So any thoughts on what he was wearing at the time?
A lot of how color comes out is dependent on a wide variety of variables, all the way down to the age of the chemicals, the temperature of the room, the amount of humidity in the room when it's shot, the type of light, the amount of light, the color of the light, the length of the exposure, the length of the development process. I've had a bunch of people ask me, there's debate recently, the photo of the Confederate soldiers on the streets in Frederick, Maryland. There's debate as to whether it's from the Antietam campaign or whether it's from like the Fort Stevens campaign or like Monocacy campaign. And they're like, oh, well, can you tell if it's English Army cloth or if it's this or that? I'm like, I really can't, because I don't know what time of day it was shot. I don't know where it was shot. I don't know. As Brandon can attest to, we have a chair in the studio that we do all our test photos on whenever we're making new batches of chemicals. And we probably have thrown away 100+ tin types of this chair, and they all look different. Every single one looks different. And we're shooting in the same room with the same camera with roughly the same chemicals every single time. Sometimes the mid-tones come out great. Sometimes it's almost flat black. Sometimes it's completely blown out. The variables of this camera and the collodion photography system that we use can really, really make a huge difference as far as how things come out sometimes. But there is kind of a general rule that it always kind of works under as well, too. It can be widely affected by a lot of other conditions. Now, having seen that photo several times, I'm 99% sure he's wearing dark blue trousers in that one. I don't see any way that regular sky blue trousers, which tend to come out very, very light gray in wet plate, just because of how light blue they tend to be. I don't see any way where you could cast a shadow that it would come out looking the way it does with the amount of detail that it has without it being very obviously a shadow. So I'm pretty sure he's wearing dark blue trousers. I don't know whether those were issued to the 14th or not, or if even frock coats were issued to the 14th.
Yeah, and it's I don't know exactly when that photograph was taken. The 14th did go to war. They left Connecticut with dark blue frocks and dark blue trousers. But I don't believe that at that time, Joseph Pierce would have been a corporal. So it's possible that maybe this is something he had made afterwards. They did purchase and have, you know, things made for them. So maybe it's a slightly different shade of dark blue, because it is actually a really nice coat that he's wearing in the picture. Like, I'm looking at that like, wow, how do I get that made? I think I want a copy of that.
And we always forget that, you know, they were being resupplied throughout the war. And I've seen photos of guys hanging out around Appomattox wearing dark blue trousers. You wonder, like, where are these from? How long have they been kicking around in these dark blue pants, or when did they get reissued in dark blue trousers? There's a wild amount of both ordnance and quartermaster stuff that kind of defies what we normally accept as far as what Union soldiers were getting issued throughout the war.
Yeah, and Joseph Pierce has an interesting story unto himself, too. He, like you said, he was born in China, and he was actually brought to the United States by what would be his adoptive father, Amos Peck. He was a ship captain. So in his trading route back and forth, he brought him home here to Connecticut and joined up with the 14th Connecticut before they left Connecticut. He was in Company F, and there are references to him being in service at several important points during the war. And in the regimental history, they reference him in both, I think, in Chancellorsville, but then also in particular Gettysburg. He was there. And then I believe after Gettysburg, he was sent back home to Connecticut to begin the recruiting process to help restore the depleted ranks, as 14th left Gettysburg with just over 100 guys out of 1,000 from 10 months, 11 months before, and they needed to refill.
And that could very easily have been when that photo was taken as part of a promotional thing. You never know. You know, there's all kinds of what ifs surrounding Civil War photography that I would love to just know details. You know, we see all these pictures and it's like, they tell us so much, but then there's also so much we just don't know from them. It was already referenced, you know, the sharpshooter photo. We don't know anything about this guy, but we've all seen his picture. We don't know anything about the Harvest of Death photo. We're not entirely sure who that is or who's in it. We don't know anything about the 3 Confederate prisoners at Gettysburg who may have been surgeons. It may have been taken on July 3rd. It may have been taken as late as July 8th. Nobody knows. And it's frustrating, infuriating that we never will, but we can always just enjoy and appreciate these photos for what they are and the time capsule that they left us.
Well, and I think your assumption is right, because I'm looking him up here in the Library of Congress, and the back of his CDV says W. Hunt, photographer, 532 Chapel Street in New Haven, Connecticut. So that's either when he was sent back for recruiting or shortly thereafter. On a semi-related note, are you able to, I got to imagine that when they had these little shops and they would have just a factory, right? Picture after picture after picture of soldiers coming in wanting to get themselves documented in uniform. So you're going to have a lot of the same props or backgrounds. Are you able to tell sometimes, like, oh yeah, this was taken in so-and-so studio? Is there enough of that evidence in the photograph where you can tell where it was originated from?
On my old computer, I actually used to have 3 different folders that just said Brady Floor. Brady replaced his floor in his studio midway through the war. And so you can date a photo by which floor is down there. He had 2 different parlors and one of them stayed pretty consistent throughout the war. The other one changed floors. So you can look at the carpet or tile or whatever's in there and like, oh, well, this is 61 or 62. And then anything after that, you know, that's Brady's studio, but a different time period. So yeah, there's certain things that you can tell. Obviously, the very famous, the Jeff Davis in the South photos, there's Confederate soldiers. We don't know where they're taken. We don't know when they had to be 1861. Nobody's really in any kind of uniform. And we're assuming they're in the deep South, like Louisiana, Mississippi. But they all have the same table with the same tablecloth and the same Jeff Davis in the South sign. Most of them are holding the same little prop pistol, too. So there are a couple where it's like, ah, I've seen that one before. I've seen that backdrop before. There was almost an entire ship's crew that was photographed like 2x2 because I had 2 reenactors come in and recreate one of those original photos of a black sailor and a white sailor. And they came in and did it. And another one of my photography friends was like, oh, I've seen that, because we based it off of an original. And somebody said, oh, I've seen that original. Here it is. And it was a different photo of 2 different sailors. So I was like, well, that's not the same one. And so we put it up there on forum. Someone's like, oh, I know which one that is. And put yet a third one for the exact same studio, 2 sailors, 1 black, 1 white. It's like, how many of these exist? You know, they must have just been to save time bringing them in pairs and just trying to like cycle them all through. And so we're getting 2 guys standing on either side of a pillar with a boat painted on a backdrop. And they must have just been cycling, just keep going on through.
It's wild. Yeah, there are like Facebook groups out there filled with tintype collectors, specifically of Civil War military images. And I swear, some of these people in these groups just have an encyclopedic knowledge of every photographer's backdrop that was used during the war. Like someone can throw up a picture of, I don't know, some Union soldier in front of a painted backdrop of like a military camp in the background with like a very particular little flag with exactly 34 stars on it. Like, oh, does anybody know exactly where this was taken? Someone immediately will jump on in like, I don't know, 10 minutes and say, yep, Camp Curtin, Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, approximately between 1862 and 63. There you go. It's pretty wild, but there's people who can really pinpoint these things.
I think that even kind of goes back a little bit to the little shop thing. Dan, what was the address that you said that photo was taken of Joseph Pierce?
Probably a New Haven pizza place now.
Probably is.
Yeah, look, I just had it up. I just had backed out of it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Come on, man.
My opportunity to officially go on record for hating New Haven style pizza.
Oh,
remember,
heartbreaking.
Are they the ones that burn the crust?
Yeah, they're the ones that burn the crust. They're like, oh no, we char it. You don't char a pizza crust. meat chars.
I love my charred pizza.
Same.
It's the worst. Like, and I've been to better places in Connecticut. I was just at Mango's in Mystic, and they do, I wouldn't say a char, but they do put that little bit of wood fire burn on it. I've been to all the pizza places in New Haven. I've tried the clam pie at Frank Pepe's. I've tried everything at Modern. I've been to Sal's, been to a bar. Yeah, ugh. I don't like any of them. They're no good.
It's because they're using collodion in their, they're using old collodion that they found.
Not.
They better not be.
Yeah.
We're all in trouble.
Make it onto the bonus episode for like the Patreon subscribers or something like that.
No, this
I
is
had Chicago deep dish pizza way over in, Malnetti's in Chicago. Oh man, that's the best I've ever had. That was awesome.
Oh, and they're not even like my top four in Chicago. So,
Yankee, that's the first experience I had over there. So
it's good stuff. So I'm originally from that area, and I'm not even like a Chicago deep dish fan. I'd go for a Chicago tavern style, like Palmero's on 63rd. Like, it's just the perfect Chicago pizza. But everyone thinks of, you know, deep dish for Chicago style, but the real Chicago style is the tavern cut. That's the good stuff. But yeah, if you get out to Chicago again, try like Pequod's or Nancy's or even like Giordano's. That's my go-to when it comes to like Chicago deep dish.
Tavern cut looks so wrong.
It's so good though. It's so good.
What do you mean?
Oh, you can't talk about how to cut a pizza when you go to Frank Pepe's and they cut it they cut it in a rhombus. I don't know what they're doing there. It's a mess.
Listen, hey, at least you get crust on each slice. That looks wrong. Look up Altoona style pizza, a real central PA style.
Oh, bad. I think I've seen this.
It's like Velveeta cheese on a piece of sourdough.
Oh, God. Yeah,
it's
no, that's
not that bad. It's really
I've had it.
I'm sure it's good. I mean, it's all the ingredients taste great. It's just like, it looks like what you would make when you're like 12 and your parents were like, all right, find dinner for yourself. We're going to go out.
Well, the one that looks even worse than that is like Ohio Valley pizza, where the crust and the saucer are served hot and they pile the cheese and toppings on cold. It just looks like an adult Lunchable, but man, it's good. Every time I'm in Pittsburgh, I go down to Beto's on Banksville Road and just get a pile of onions on a hot pizza. It's so good. It's a weird mouthfeel. It's not one that I go to all the time, but like sometimes you just got a hankering for Beto's.
Some of the best pizza I've ever had was not even in the U.S. and it was not in Italy. I've never been to Italy. It was actually in Finland, within the bounds of the Arctic Circle.
Interesting.
Yeah, so I'll make this really, really quick. We went, my girlfriend and I left a resort that we were staying on for our anniversary. We went into this little town in the middle of winter. There's snow everywhere. And we asked a couple of the, you know, locals there. We were like, hey, like, we're just really hungry, looking for a bite to eat. And they were like, oh, you got to try the new pizza place. And I was like, pizza? And they were like, yeah, I think it was named like Fiero or Fieno. I forget the name of it, but we walked up to it. This place is covered in snow. And we went inside and this was like perfect New York style pizza. I was completely blown away. I was not expecting that in the Arctic Circle. So anyway,
did they have any like super weird toppings up there?
Yeah. They had like a whole menu and it was all like, you know, there were, I forget some of the names
of
them,
fish,
but
I guess, right?
Yeah, there were some, there was like a reindeer meat topping. Mm-hmm. There was like definitely some seafood ones. I think I ended up going with like the traditional margarita because I was not feeling adventurous at that point.
Yeah, see, but the worst I've ever had has been up that way where it was in Denmark and that's just like, you ever, you know, from The Office where they describe the difference between Alfredo's Pizza Cafe and Pizza by Alfredo.
Yeah.
It's a hot circle of garbage, right? That's kind of what that was. But you know what? After a week of eating pickled herring and fish with fish sauce and all, I'm just eating it and I'm going, you know what? This is really bad pizza. I just don't care right now because I'm just so tired of everything else. So to bring us back to the original question,
Have you ever photographed a pizza? That's how we'll get back on topic now.
Oh man, no, I haven't, but now I need to.
I would love to actually see that. That'd be...
I photographed a lot of random weird stuff during the pandemic. I don't know if you remember, there was that some performance artist like duct taped a banana to a wall and it sold for like $10 million. So I duct taped a banana to our wall and took a tintype of it. And I was like, where's my $1 million? And yeah, it got a lot of hits. I sold a handful of copies of that.
One other interesting photo, I was scrolling through your Instagram earlier. You do the cemetery photos where you have the person who's ghost-like either next to somebody or next to a gravestone. I just think those are super cool. And leading up to like spooky season, you know,
I'm going to be the next month. I have
that's popular requests.
I think I have 5 or 6 cemetery gigs in October. I'll be doing Mount Laurel Cemetery in Philly. I'll be doing, I don't remember the name, in Pittsburgh. I'll be Allegheny Cemetery in Pittsburgh. I'll be doing Sleepy Hollow. And I have one more and I don't remember where that one is. I think it's in Wilkes-Barre. So I got a bunch coming up. Spooky season is upon us. I will be at every cemetery. So that's my thing. So you brought up the ghost photography. And basically, as soon as photography was invented, the trick photography was invented as well, too. People could find out you could do all kinds of crazy stuff with these cameras and make things happen that weren't actually, you know, real. One of those, of course, is the ghost or spirit photograph. And right after the Civil War, spiritualism takes hold and, you know, big tent revivals and mediums and the Fox sisters, they're from up your way, I think. All the, you know, the seances and readings. And I don't think the Ouija board comes around quite yet, but things along those lines are very, very popular. And a guy in New England, I guess I do know a New England guy, his name's Mumler, and he becomes like the spirit photograph guy. He's the one who does the Mary Todd Lincoln spirit photograph and all this other stuff. And so he's got a really convincing setup and people are like, wow, man, this guy's really actually capturing ghosts. Except they start noticing that some of those ghosts look very much like townspeople who live in his area. And there becomes some debate and then there becomes a lawsuit and then it becomes a trial. With Mumler, and is he a fraud and a shyster, and is he you know, like pulling the wool over people's eyes? So they send photographers to go watch him do his thing, and so they're in the studio with him and watch, but they don't go in the dark room. And then they're just like, well, we didn't see any ghosts in the room while he was shooting, so he must be on the level, we can't figure it out. And that blows my mind that in the court reports, like the guys who were supposed to go in and like watch every step of it really only watched the first part. And they're like, I guess everything's fine. I would have gone with him into the dark room and be like, all right, where in the process are these ghosts showing up? So I have a theory about how Mumler did it. Like I can create a ghost photograph very, very simply by just doing a rudimentary double exposure. Like let's say we've got two people in my studio. One of them wants to be a ghost. One of them is not going to be a ghost. The one who is not a ghost is going to sit for the entirety of the exposure. Let's say it's 12 seconds. In my studio, the ghost needs to stay in the photo for about 7 seconds. So I open up the lens. They're both in the photo. I close the lens. The ghost steps out and I reopen the lens again without the ghost in it. And so it's essentially shooting the photo again on the plate, but this time the other person's not there. So it's layering the background over them and making them very transparent. In Photoshop, that would be just like importing another image, sliding the opacity bar down. It's about the same thing. It's actually easier to do a double exposure on a wet plate than it would be for me to take like 3 digital photos, cut and paste, and mess with the opacity. It's way easier to just do it once on my old-timey camera. There's an easy way to do it, but that clearly wasn't what Mumler was doing. I also have never once, he was shooting it all on glass, but I've never once seen a true glass negative of any of Mumler's plates. I've only seen CDBs or any kind of albumen prints. What I think he was doing is taking the glass plate that he shot in the studio and then also layering on another glass plate with another person's image on it. When he's making the CDV, when he's layering those on out in the sun, he can be putting images on top of images. And there's a process called the relievio type, where when the image is still wet, you can scrape off the collodion that's on the plate and leaving just the subject. So you can easily lay that down on top of another photo that's been shot at the studio, and you don't get a weird like double backdrop. You just get a subject that you can leave on for a very short amount of time because they're going to be ghostly. And then they kind of lose a little of that detail anyway. He could have easily bought a Lincoln glass plate since there was really no photo copyright back then. So he could just buy one of those images if he needed to. And then he could have used that in the Mary Todd Lincoln photo. So that's my theory as to how he had it done. It's not something I've tried yet. Making actual albumen prints is messy and time consuming and expensive. And like, it's a lot easier to just lay it on a flatbed scanner and do it that way. So we don't do true albumen at the studio, but it's something I'm going to eventually be offering as workshops for people who want to like try it. You know, we'll shoot a glass negative and then we'll go out and make prints of it. But outside of that, I'm not doing it for resale. That's kind of my theory is how Mumler was doing it. He never got convicted, but his name kind of got dragged through the mud. Everybody was kind of realizing it's kind of a sham. But spirit photography, which I'm glad you brought up, especially coming into October, was a huge thing and a very huge thing in New England.
I just looked that up and I'm going to have nightmares now.
Yeah, I was like this tempted to look it up and I was like, no, you know what? I scare too easily. I'm just not going to look. A little outside of the scope of the Civil War, but there was also, I believe, in England, a person who faked seeing fairies in their garden, and it wasn't like a double exposure kind of thing. I think it was like paper cutouts that were just like highly detailed, but they had fooled at least a handful of people within their personal circle.
Yep. In fact, I just did a private party for a bunch of costumers, and that was kind of the theme. And so we were kind of recreating those fairy photos with real people. And so we had a bunch of like oversized props, like a huge dandelion and a bunch of other stuff. So it was a lot of fun kind of doing those. And so a lot of people caught on to what we were doing. Like, oh, it's just like those. There was a name for that photographer, and I can't remember what it was.
It's the Cottingley Fairies. By photographs taken by Elsie Wright and Francis Griffiths, two young cousins.
Yep, that's what we were going for. So for being a very rudimentary style of photography, you can do a lot of crazy stuff with it.
How often did people fall for the Mary Todd Lincoln photos and photos of that type during the time period? Was that like, I know they had a whole trial about it for that New England guy, but...
I mean, they still do. Like, look at any Facebook post and you're going to get a whole bunch of boomers who are just
That's
like,
oh, point.
I can't believe I saw like Joe Biden jumping out of a helicopter onto a school. I'm like, yeah, well,
that's what Obama had snake eyes.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, you can put anything out there and somebody's going to believe it. And it was the same in the 1860s and even more so because they weren't accustomed to not believing what they saw. We've, especially younger generations, we live in the world of CGI and AI and Photoshop and having to train ourselves to question whether what we're seeing is the real thing or not. And to the point where we're like, we just go to the movies just to suspend belief because we know it's all fake, you know, and they grew up only knowing that what they saw is what they saw and that really truly existed. So the first time they see something that isn't real, even look at like silent movies in the 1920s and stuff like that, the amount of people who passed out or fainted during that short film of a guy pointing a gun at the screen and shooting, you know, crazy stuff like that, or freaking out when a train is coming right at them. We have that ability to suspend belief that people didn't grow up with back then. Seeing a ghost in a photo meant you saw a ghost in a photo. And it would probably take more convincing to tell you that it's not real than tell you that it is real.
It's like P.T. Barnum said, there's a sucker born every day. And P.T. Barnum in the Victorian era, during the Civil War era, took advantage of a lot of people. And growing up without that ability to discern allowed a lot of charlatans to take advantage of a lot of people. Which is exactly what William Mumler did. He took advantage of people who were grieving, who wanted to have one last contact with somebody they cared about. And he took their money and gave them a fake.
Person to be proud of for our New England heritage. Guys got anybody who's not a fraud?
No, that's it. That's all that comes from New England. Sorry.
Brandon said something that's going to like bang around in my head for the next few days as I process this. Up until this time, right, people didn't know what their even like grandparents look like. That is something I'm going to be thinking about for I don't know how long, right? So all of a sudden now you have the ability to see what your ancestors, even a couple of generations now, look like, you know, and for most people that would have been the first time, right? Because they didn't have, they weren't rich, they weren't going to have a painting of themselves like Brandon was talking about. And so how that brought that humanity to society and culture, and really in the war, right? So now you had these pictures of soldiers left at home while they are away. So you've actually got something physical there that represents that person who is missing from the family for months or years at a time, and how that, you know, brought them, it's more than a memory. It's going to be right there in front of that family.
Yeah. I mean, I clearly never met my great-great-grandmother. You know, she died in the early 19-teens, but I walk by her photo every single day.
And that's kind of adds a level of sadness too, when you go to these thrift stores or swap meets or the big, huge flea markets where mm-hmm. you just see like dozens and dozens and dozens of these unnamed pictures of people that obviously that was very important to them to have that picture taken at that time. And it was, oh yeah, that's so-and-so. And that's my mother. That's my, you know, cousin. And now that image is just lost to history. Most of my ancestors during the Civil War, I'm fortunate to have one of them. I can count on one hand of that 32 person generation, you know, part mm-hmm. of my tree, how many pictures I know of about them. And I always wonder, and I'm sure everybody else wonders, are there photographs of all of them and they're just out there and unnamed in the world?
They might be in somebody else's collection, you know. I think about all the pictures I have. I'm like I have this one right here. It's Mrs. Owen Sweeney, and I have Owen Sweeney too. He's not with me here on the table, but like, who's family members? I'm sure they have family that still exists in some capacity nowadays. Like, whose ancestor do I have here? You know, and would they love to get this picture back someday?
That's one of the mysteries I think that we're going to end up having to live with until we, of course, we get to the point where we get facial recognition and can cross-reference all those random pictures, and maybe there's a detail or two.
Well, we've also even lost the medium of physical photos anymore. Couldn't, other than tintypes, I couldn't show you any physical photos of myself in the last decade. I couldn't tell you the last time I printed out a photo, like a modern photo of myself. And I work in photography. We don't have photo albums. Like, that's going to be a thing of the past. I was even talking to another friend. It's like, are cemeteries going to go away? Because a lot of people my generation, or even my parents' generation, like, are choosing to be cremated. Like, also, a lot of my ancestors grew up, lived, and died in the same area. Nobody I know does that anymore.
No, that's a great point too, is that, you know, that used to be a sense of comfort for people back then, is knowing that they were going to be in the family plot down the road mm-hmm. with everybody else, with all their ancestors. And, you know, I used to have that romantic notion too, but now I'm kind of like, I don't really want to be able to point to the spot where I'm going to be.
Yeah.
That seems to be much more common nowadays.
And that right. ties back to our discomfort with our mortality, right? That's probably the whole shift for our generation, is death has become a taboo. So unlike the Victorians yeah. who found comfort in that, now it's like, ooh, spooky to see that.
We have this culture of fear and horror and spookiness around cemeteries, which, you know, as Dave alluded to before, I mean, yeah, at Victorian Photography Studio, we have fun with that because it is fun. But I think what we like to harken back to with our work and what we do is kind of a sense of comfort with that. I don't know about you guys. I have a feeling pretty much everybody on this podcast is probably just like me and likes to hang out in old cemeteries because they're cool. Not only are they cool, but you are surrounded by stories, people's stories that went across the globe and ended right where you're standing. And you might never be able to tease out all the details of them, but they're all right there around you. And there's something just beautiful about that. And I kind of hope that maybe that's something that'll change in our generation. I've got a really good friend who's a funeral director, and she really believes in this ethos called death positivity, where you recognize death is just part of life, and that's okay. And it's nothing to be afraid of. You embrace it, and you embrace the beauty of where our stories eventually end. I don't know. And I think that's just something that sticks in the back of my mind. Anytime I work with a historical process, whether I'm doing historical interpretation or specifically wet plate photography. I think about all the plates that I shoot and I'm like, these plates may very well outlive the people that are in them, because all of the old tintypes that I have from the 1850s and 1860s sitting on my bookshelf over here, or all the ones that Dave has on his or that Dan has on his, those people are long gone, but those images are still here. You know, maybe as we've moved away from having physical photographs these days, maybe these tintypes will serve that purpose again. Maybe we'll still have a physical reminder of us somewhere that isn't in the cloud. And I think somehow that's kind of nice.
This was a wonderful episode. I just want to take some time to thank you, Dave and Brandon, for joining us this evening, taking time out of your busy schedules to educate us about 19th century photography. If you're in Gettysburg again, make sure you visit Dave and Brandon and Kim at Victorian Photo Studio on Steinwehr Avenue in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania.
I'm hoping you haven't recognized my name, because I've had to cancel two appointments so far with you based on the weather. It's just always around Remembrance Day. But yes, I want to get there.
So
one of these days when the stars align. Excellent. No, fantastic. Yep.
So you just missed me in Connecticut. I was there last weekend. So another opportunity shot.
Now you can charge more money. That's for the inconvenience.
Thanks, Cara. Yeah, thanks.
You're welcome.
And I think we're done with the podcast today.
Yeah. Dave, Brandon, anything you guys want to add?
You want to plug anything so people can find you?
You can follow us on Instagram at VPS_Gettysburg. And of course, our Facebook is Victorian Photography Studio.
Some upcoming events we have going on. At the end of September, we have our big, big annual Living History Day. We're going to have a number of military reenactors there, civilian interpreters, displays, museum tours. So there is plenty to do for the whole family, and we are excited to see you there.
So thank you for your continued support with this podcast. As always, you can find us on Spotify, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, and YouTube. It really helps when you give us a rating. So for a rating, tell us what you think about it.
And if you wouldn't mind considering joining the Friends of the Museum for the New England Civil War Museum, that really goes a long way in helping us put together programming and new experiences and new exhibits and new artifacts and new stories to be told here. You also, in signing up, you have different levels, but there are member-only exclusive benefits as well. So please consider joining. You can either contact us through the website, newenglandcivilwarmuseum.com, or you can email us at friendsofthecwmuseum@gmail.com.
And I'll add one more thing. If you are in the New England area and you can't get down to Gettysburg, but you'd still either love to have a portrait done or love to participate in a workshop and learn how to do wet plate collodion, we are in your area in Stonington, Connecticut annually, usually in September. And we're always looking for new places to host us. So if you have a historic site or a tattoo shop or a brewery or whatever, any place where you'd like to host wet plate collodion photography, shoot us an email. VPSGettysburg@gmail.com, or find us on our Instagram. We're already booking for 2024. We'll be kind of in the area in Boston next year. We'll be at Lyndhurst Manor in Sleepy Hollow. So we get to your area, Ghost Ship Market in Salem will be there. So keep an eye out for us. We do travel up to New England, so you don't always have to come down to Gettysburg. You can find us when we're on the road.
Great. And with that, we will close this episode of History in the Haversack. Thank you very much for joining us, and we will see you in the next episode.